Hi there, this is James Chai, Arf Arf Bark Bark Rescue Foundation, and I am doing a bit of a late broadcast today. I apologize, I just got back from a session with a very cool couple, and there we go, we're just getting online here, and really cool couple. They actually, I'll get into that in just a little bit there. What I've done today is a little bit different, especially since I was running a bit behind. I decided to put up some of the notes beforehand. Usually I kind of improv things, and I don't really have too much of a structure to it because I like to be really organic. And when it comes to this, tonight I just decided, yesterday I decided I'll just put up some stuff because some things came to me. I wasn't really feeling it yesterday having a session so early. So what I put down here, today's October 4th, 2019. This is episode broadcast number 10. It's not about fearful or dangerous dogs, so I'll have to fix that. I'll have to clear that. And let me just see here. So I wrote down there, have a read through tonight's live broadcast notes. I think you guys will be pleasantly surprised with some of the topics that I'm thinking of talking about. I'll be reading them aloud. So it'll not be like as if you're hearing an author read their entire book publicly. More so, you'll be hearing me not just read my own words, you'll be hearing me organically processing my own words aloud. So this part is going to be a bit different. And I want to thank a couple people. Let me just see here. I want to thank some of my new subscribers to my YouTube channel, Kevin Smith and Tracy X. Eileen Thorson. What I want to say also is a subscriber by the name of Cassian, which was just a really cool thing that they commented. I don't know if they're male or female. And interesting, because I talk about the fact that, you know, what I do, a lot of people, a lot of the trainers' behaviors, my colleagues are quite resistant and derogatory towards me. It happens here locally. It's just brutal. There's just that request in their own minds to just protect the littlest things in their life, and then go after anything else that might be a possible, new direction in dog training, and especially dog psychology at the root psychogenetic part. So Cassian actually commented on my episode number 4, September 28th, 2019. What he says, or she says, since you're talking about controversial scientists who were mocked in their time, you can also add, and I'm going to hopefully say this name properly, and I've put it in the notes with the wiki link, is Ignaz Semmelweis to the list, which is actually even more relevant to the case. He found out that hygiene was necessary for proper medical procedures. This is back in the 1800s. And, that's a time when if somebody was having a heart attack in front of the doctor would just stand there and not do anything because they didn't know what to do, because CPR didn't exist in the 1800s or even in the early 1900s. And so the case was, if someone died, you just died. I think it was in the 50s or 60s when CPR was developed or discovered, invented, and that's what saved people's lives. So what Cassian writes is, he found out that hygiene was necessary for proper medical procedures, but common sense at the time had other doctors mock him for it. They didn't want to accept that not washing their hands, not keeping their tools sterile, meant that they were harming their patients. It was easier to say that Ignaz was crazy instead of embracing this crazy, weird, novel thing. And in actual fact, what happened to him, if you look at the wiki notes, is that he lived from 1818 to 1865, short longevity, a Hungarian physicist, a physician and scientist. He was then declared insane and put into an asylum at that time, which we know is really bad, and then he subsequently died there. But he was mocked and attacked by his colleagues, ostracized obviously by being put in an insane asylum. Do I feel like that? Absolutely, 100%. I have something that I've discovered that modernizes dog training. It addresses the dogs at the root psychogenetic aspects of it that science, academia, PhDs, That behaviorist that I emailed yesterday, she hadn't responded, so I'll probably put that link in my thing tomorrow or on Sunday. So she hasn't responded at all, and she's not going to. Like I've been told, the people at the top of the food chain never want to be shown that they're wrong. And unfortunately, when they don't want to be shown that they're wrong, they're not doing it for science, they're doing it for ego. And that ego is damaging, because that ego destroys lives and it causes the dogs to be the victims. When you have a reactive dog, anybody with a reactive dog knows that when you're walking around and you're in a relationship with somebody and your dog is reactive and the two of you are walking with your reactive dog, it causes that relationship to be quite strained, because people are already antsy because they're worried. One person or both of the couples are already worried whether or not someone is going to attack, whether the dog is going to attack somebody else's dog or person. So everybody's on alert and they're all freaked out and they're always in tension, and it causes the relationship to have a deeper subliminal divide in between them, because they're already amped up, and by the time they get home they can't relax, etc. And when I've worked with my clients, couples, and with their dog, and they're happier to see how their dog has settled down, they have always remarked that their relationship has been a lot easier and they feel more at ease when they're outside with their dog, because they're now able to calm their dog down and reset their dog, bring them home. The dog is still a happier dog, more content dog, and then they have less issues that are going on. Interestingly enough, the couple that I was with today, and it is Colleen and Mike, and they're just a great couple, a really nice couple, and they actually had hired a trainer, a well-known trainer here in town, and bought a package deal. And unfortunately, it's just they realized that they were not making the right decision. So they hired me, and I saw them today, and it was great. I mean, they got two medium-sized dogs, about 70, 80 pounds. And one dog is quite reactive, both females, and they're bonded. They come from the same litter, actually. They got them at separate times. And one of them is reactive to people, and they had issues about that. And we worked it out in one session, and a significant difference. But the most profound aspect of it is I was able to describe to them at the root level of psychology, of the dog's psychology, of both dogs' psychology, what their issues were. And we're talking about low self-esteem, insecurity of one dog. The other dog is the aspect of a certain type of confidence, and how that dog is able to exist without her sister, her bonded sister, because of a certain level of confidence, etc. So we want to always look at the dynamics. And that's what I do for the couple and for the family, is looking at the dynamics, explain to them what it is that they need to make adjustments with their dog, so that their dog is not trying to attack me or attack other people that are coming to the home. And without medication, without treats, without any voodoo, any prong collars or any brute force aspects of it, I'm able to show them and explain to them the nuanced behaviors of everything that was going on, and when to acknowledge their dog, when to provide affection to their dog. And it was absolutely brilliant. Mike, the husband, started picking up on his own intuition and seeing and sensing these things. And in a matter of minutes, they were able to get their one concerning reactive dog to come to him on her own for affection. When she felt anxiety or anxious, he was able to bring her to him, or she would come to him for that being consoled and being felt that she was protected and safe. And this was great, because we went outside, and they live in a complex. And the complex, anywhere inside the complex, they said the primary dog, the more reactive dog, was being quite reactive to people as they walk by, etc. But once they're out on the sidewalk, on the street, then that dog is not as reactive. And so, you know, obviously explain that it's a territorial aspect of it. It's a limitation of that environment to that one dog. And on top of that, the dog knows their area. They can recognize the pavement. They can recognize the landscape. They can recognize the fact that there's a difference in their home environment, the common areas, the driveway, the road through their complex, versus being outside of their property and then dog then understands, okay, I'm in a different place. Because the curiosity on their on the parents' end were, well, why is she like this inside, but outside she's pretty cool. So we worked on that, explaining that aspect of the dynamics, and then there was another couple of people that walked by, and one guy who came towards their dog, the main reactive dog, was quite agitated, and then he was able to calm her down just by doing the techniques, simple techniques, bring her in for a hug, putting his hand in a certain position on her body, on the dog's body, speaking to their dog in a certain tone of voice, a certain rhythm, a certain tone key, a certain voice key, which the dog then understood. And it got to the point when we came back from our 15-20 minute walk, the same guy happened to leave the complex, and I think it was 3 barks and that was it. And then she did a lot of crying and whining, but Mike was able to calm her down. And he was just like, wow, this is amazing. And the progress was amazing. And you know, they were very impressed with everything. And they're canceling their appointment with a well-known behaviorist as well. So I saved them like another $600-$700 right off the bat right there. And what that behaviorist would have done would have been, well, there's something wrong with your dog. It's a behavioral issue. Here's some medication. And like I said yesterday, medication, what are you talking about medication? If the dog has a psychological issue and you're prescribing medication, which are, you know, psychopharmaceuticals to address to address behavior with psychopharmaceuticals, means that the dog has a psychological issue. And because the dog is not rampant and committed fully into that psychological dysfunction, that dog can be addressed. The dogs that are committed to that psychological dysfunction are predatorial, and they're quite significant, and then submerge like an iceberg. So it's identifying those issues, breaking them apart, and then when you understand the root causes, the root issues of each psychological affectation of the dog, it's very easy to address it. And so that's what I do, is I make that adjustment, show them what to do, and I said to them, the most important part is practice, practice, practice. Do the basics over and over and over again in the beginning. Do the basics, do the basics, do the basics. And as you progress, you do less and less, like a sculpture that is with the artist that just whittles it down into this fine, incredible piece of art, organic art. That's what we want to do with the dogs as well in regards to the psychological behavior. And that's kind of something that was interesting, as Mike said, is that they've gone through and they've looked through a bunch of you know, online and websites and people who have 10 and 12 and 15,000 followers on their top behaviors and trainers. And the majority of them are always talking about the fact that they themselves, their own dogs, they can't handle themselves. The biggest problem is when you're at the top of the food chain, the last thing you want is to be confronted by a dog that you can't handle. So what you do, usually, is you meet the clients, and you're like, oh yeah, we're going to deal with the dog, da, 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 even though they know that they don't know what to do. And then they say, well, you know what? It's your dog's fault. There's something wrong with your dog. You should rehome your dog. You should surrender your dog, or in worst case, desperate scenarios for these reputations that they have to protect, you should kill your dog. There's no way to fix your dog. We don't fix psychological issues in human beings, but it's okay to fix psychological issues in dogs with treats or medication, and that is counterintuitive. As I've said before, nowhere in the entire canine species does food exist as a communication tool. I've challenged so many of my critics, prove me wrong. Where in the entire canine species does food exist as a communication device? And then they start attacking me in different ways. So I love the fact that Cassian put that there. It's great to have that feeling of people who are actually modernized, like yourselves who are watching my broadcast, and are understanding that there is a different way to approach and deal with dogs. And that is to deal with dogs on the psychological level. You know, if you have a bad day at work and you feel like quitting and you're really upset, you get home and you're by yourself and you want to just vent, you're going to call the person that's going to talk you off the ledge. You're not going to call the person that is going to say, yeah, your job sucks and you should find another job. They don't appreciate you there. You're going to phone the person that's going to talk you off the ledge. That's what we do with our dogs, is we talk them off the ledge. we help them off the ledge by showing them that they're safe. As I said before, dogs are overt codependent, which means that our dogs are looking to us to be protected by us. And that's the most important part that trainers and behaviorists need to understand. Those who are actually vested and really want to improve and change the lives of dogs, that's what they need to understand, is the overt codependency that dogs have. And they are not, you know, afraid of human beings. I mean, my gosh, you know, that's what that I think Sheila Begg from Dizing Canine thing said. And I was like, you know what, you're wrong. Dogs aren't fearful. How can you say that when scientists are saying dogs are already cohabitating with human beings? You know, the ones that are domesticated, not the stray or the wild dogs that I've talked about in different broadcasts. So you can't go and say that the dog is fearful of human beings, yet the dog is cohabitating lovingly with the human being, and then say that that's, you know, then you have dissonance. You have that divergence of intellectual thought, I guess, logic. So it's just one of those things that, again, for those of you who are watching, you know, the live broadcast or not, if you could please share my post, if you could please subscribe to my YouTube channel. The more people that are subscribed, the more people that are sharing, that means the more people will start to learn and understand that there is a modern psychological way to address dogs at the root level, the same way we address it with our friends, our human friends, and so forth like that. If you could please share my post. I want to do a real lovely thank you to Tina Wong for sharing my post in like 7 or 8 different groups already tonight. And I really appreciate this because, you know, I know I just, it helped and it's very touching. What I also want to say too is I received somebody who asked me about whether or not I was doing a live broadcast on Facebook through YouTube. And that was kind of cool. Digital Friday said, is a live broadcast on FB. And I got to tell you, I was really touched by that, Digital Friday. Really touched by that because that made me feel like people are listening. People are watching. And I guess that's the biggest difficulty is I've been attacked so much and so often for so long. Regardless of being recognized by the Court of New York, regardless of, you know, major newspapers, and you know, I shared earlier today national television coverage from a while back. None of that matters to me. All that matters is getting out what I do out to the rest of the world, and that by teaching people how to do it themselves means that you don't think of killing your dog, that you don't think of surrendering your dog, that you start to understand your dog. And like with Colleen and Mike tonight, was being able to explain to them that there's much more of a connection, that we're using our dog's name and not calling our dog the dog. We're using their name and we're making that that emotional connection. And there's a difference when you're calling out your dog's name. They know who they are then. They understand who they are. Okay, so let me switch over. And then I'm going to talk through here. So I've got a few things here that I had put together. I'm not going to go through them all, but I'm going to talk about the first topic, and I might talk about the other one. You know, I'll go through it all here. Dogs going pee should always be acknowledged, right? So yeah, I'll probably do that, and I might do the one at the bottom, which I really want to talk about, is going over bumps in cars. You know, when your dog is in the back seat and you're going, or a front seat and you're going over a bump and so forth, and I'll get to that. Please remind me if I forget. You know, and it's kind of cool. This is, like I said, this is my 10th episode. And, you know, when I first started, I was super nervous, introverted, and even yesterday after my thing, I was like, ah. But, you know, if I can get my message out, sharing my work is what, let me know that there are more people out there who do want to save dogs' lives and who do want to understand their dog viscerally, intellectually, logically, emotionally, psychologically, to a point that it'll blow away every single behaviorist and scientist and master dog trainer, period. All these guys don't understand what I'm talking about, and they criticize me, and they go all over this, but none of them can do any of the stuff that I'm doing. And they go, oh, well, you know, you flooded the dogs. Yeah, right. 2 weeks later, the dog's just hanging out there, no problem at all. As opposed to giving the dog a piece of food, a treat. Like I said, food doesn't exist in the dog world at all, but we're giving food to the dog thinking that's going to work. That's a human arrogance. That's our human arrogance. And that's the arrogance of those people who are not open to understanding dogs and that behavior. Okay, so dogs going pee should always be acknowledged. And what I mean by that is if you're walking with your dog on leash, off leash, whatever, and you're walking and they stop to go pee, make eye contact with them. And I recall there was like an article about that, like, I don't know, 2-3 years ago. It was kind of talking about it, but they didn't really understand what it was. They just say, you know, walk your dog, okay? So what it is when your dog is going pee, you want to make eye contact with your dog. You make eye contact with your dog, and then you look around. You're going to look at your dog, make eye contact, say their name. For example, I'm going to use Minky. Minky, hi, Minky. Well, he's going pee, making eye contact, and then I'll look around. And look around, and I'll be talking in the other direction, Minky, Minky. I'll look behind me, Minky, and then look back at my dog. So what your dog is doing is, for those dogs that are shy, they don't really make eye contact, and they do end up learning how to make eye contact because of that. Because what we're doing is, when we're looking at our dog and then looking away, we're making sure that their environment is safe, that they're not going to be attacked, and that by watching us, making eye contact with us, our dog is making sure that if I have any fear in my eyes, Mickey's going to pick that up and know there's danger. So then I make my dog safe. So that's why the other thing I said about up in the beginning about making eye contact with your dog and how trainers and behaviors out there, you know, the ones who I guess are just starting out are saying never make eye contact with your dog. My gosh, it's a trust issue. Absolute trust issue. If your dog's not making eye contact with you, it's because they don't trust you to protect them. Like I said, parenting our dogs. We already call ourselves dog parents. Let's actually apply dog parenting to our dogs. So look at your dog, peeing, so forth, like that. Now, I have, you know, 5 dogs. And so when they go out, in the order that they go out, either I let them out seniority-wise, in the order they came into the home, like I talked about in another episode, or they just happen, if I just open the door anyways and I let them out, they all run out. And depending on where they run into the yard, the ones that are stopping closer are going to go pee sooner, right? Because they're closer. So then I will say that dog's name. I don't talk about seniority as per se. I talk to the dogs in the order that they started peeing. Why does this work? Because what I'm doing is, the first dog that jumps out there and starts peeing is already exposed to danger. Doesn't matter if I have a fenced yard, does not matter. They're exposed. The same thing like when we're walking with the single dog, Minky, and paying attention, I'm going to say something. So if the first dog runs out, I'm going to say that dog's name, which, you know, say Minky run out, I'll be Minky. And then the next dog that goes pee, Lincoln. You know, next dog that goes pee, Walter. Next dog that goes pee, you know, Sammy. Next, well, Sammy doesn't have any legs, so I have to carry her out. You know, the next dog, Nero. Etc., etc., etc. And then the dogs that are peeing in order realize that their exposure is being covered in the order of seniority. The dog, our dogs, understand that we're protecting them by calling out their name each time. That makes them happy, makes them feel safe, makes them know that we, the humans, that I, the human, that I, their parent, I'm always looking out for them. Always protecting them so that there's consistency even in the backyard when our dog feels like, I don't know what's going on. We're still telling them, hey, we're watching you. Even if the dog's out there in the backyard and feeling like, oh, you know, I'm just whatever, I'm just lingering, I'm casual, I don't care, I'm not scared. We're still acknowledging them, letting our dogs know we're paying attention, letting our dogs know that the ones that are exposing themselves first to the risk when they're peeing, because they're exposed, right? Peeing or pooing, they're risking themselves by being exposed. So then I go out there and I say Minky and Lincoln in the order that the dogs all started peeing first. And if you have multiple dogs and you start doing that, you make eye contact with them, not just on the walks, but you make eye contact and you acknowledge them, you will see them making eye contact with you. And often what will happen is the dogs will start facing away from you. You know why they're facing away? Oh, you're welcome, Mike. Oh, no worries, Mike. I'm happy. Yeah, ghost. Wow. Okay. So you're facing which direction? Facing which direction? Facing which direction is it'll be happening when you start looking at your dogs? They'll start facing out different directions because they're gonna be like, okay, what are you looking at? They feel safer, but they're like, okay, what's going out? And they don't need to look behind us, behind them to me because they know I'm behind them already. So I'm watching them. So that's the next stage. And then what happens after that is, when the dogs feel even more comfortable and I'm consistent calling out their names in the order that they pee or poo, they start facing me. Because they're like, okay, I'm watching you to see if there's any danger because you've got my back, but maybe you're wrong and I feel comfortable enough to make eye contact with you as I'm exposing my back end to the backyard now and you're watching me and I'm watching to see if there's any dangers in your eyes. And then after that, then it's bang on. Then the dogs are like, whatever. And they're even more casual when they go out to pee. They just walk out because they're not in a rush and they're not concerned about peeing. Because the peeing is the urgency that the dog feels out of the bladder, the physical feeling, but psychologically too is I gotta go pee so I don't get in danger. So this is the time to do so. So that's the rudimentary aspect when we go back into the more primal aspect of the dog's behavior. Yeah, so we talked about in the order of who started peeing first, is it seniority? Eye contact when speaking to them. And then the other thing I was talking about when dogs walk up to you, but I probably won't deal with that. And okay, let's just see here. When a dog comes up to you, blah, blah, blah. All right, sorry, I get distracted by my own words because then my brain starts going off on something else about this specific aspect of it. And okay, so we're not going to do that. I don't want to talk about that. If it teaches your dog, establishing mutual codependence on a nicer emotionality. Okay, you know, actually, I am going to do that, and I'll just do that one block there, and then I'll shift down to the next one down there. And this is something actually I talked to you, Mike, and Colleen tonight before I left in regards to that. So I'm going to just lightly go over it. It's not going to be too specific, but I'm going to lightly go over it. As you know, when your dog walks up to you on their own volition, say you're just sitting on the couch. Right, and we can transfer that out into the field as well, outdoors as well. So if you're just sitting on the couch and you're just hanging out, and your dog comes up to you, and I talked before about codependency, when your dog paws at you, it is not a learned behavior, it's not a mimicked behavior, it is a cognizant behavior on the Lincoln, stop, stop yelling, Lincoln, stop yelling. There's a dog outside barking, Lincoln, stop, Lincoln. Thank you. So that's what I was talking about in another episode about dogs barking out the window. There's a dog outside barking as well. Lincoln's barking. Proof in the pudding. Stop barking. Stop yelling. Stop yelling. Thank you. Proof in the pudding. Before it started with walking him away from the window, etc., etc. So again, it's in another episode. If I remember, I'll put the link in this one so people can watch. But yeah, so when you're just sitting there on the couch, and your dog walks up to you, this is a perfect time to do passive training. Dog walks up to you, you're gonna say, and puts her the, you know, they paw at you, the codependency aspect or whatever, but they come up to you with their head towards you, looking for affection. Minky, come. Minky, come here. That's what I say when they're here. Hi, Minky. Hi, silly boy. When they're here, that's when I say that. See, I gotta stop using their names. When they approach me, I say that, and when I say that, I reinforce that passive training. But it's not even that. So I hate because that's such a crude aspect of training a dog. It's just so crude. What I am doing is I'm talking to the dog on a psychological level, on the basis where the dog themselves have created the initiative on their own to come over and seek affection by walking towards me, which is that command that I've been asking them to do in other aspects of training. So they're doing it on their own. So passively, I'm reinforcing that with them. And by them already being in a mindset where they're not already like, ah, I have to listen to the command when I'm, you know, to come. Instead, they've done it on themselves. So they're ready, for lack of a better description here and not getting too psychological, the dog is already on a roll. The dog is already in motion with an act of compliance that I don't have to ask them to do. So then I create the dog's ability to go and say to themselves, this is exactly what I wanted. my human understands the command that they've been giving me the whole time. Now they understand what it means when I come up to them by them saying come as well. So we reinforce it. So do you see how brilliant it is with dogs? Do you see the brilliance of what I'm talking about by working that psychology on a passive aspect of it? But it's not just the fact of doing it on a surface level. It's explaining why it works. The dog is already in somewhat that mindset on their own volition, on a codependency basis, on the loneliness feeling that they're having, and they're already making the conscious effort to make the decision. I'm using conversational language that is familiar, indigenous to the command training aspect of it, and the dog comes to me. So they're already coming to me on their own, then I create that part where I give them the affection, which is exactly what they were seeking. So that's the reward, fiat. That's the reward. That's not the treat. That's the reward. And I say the dog's name. And I'll say, I'm going to just make a fake name. Good job, Bill. Or good boy, Bill. Or, you know, whatever it is. And I'll say, good boy, Bill, come. Come here, Bill. And I won't be repetitive on it. I'm just going to say it once, maybe twice. And then I give them affection. And when I do give them affection, I hold my hands perfectly still along their body. Certain depends on what kind of dog and what their behavior and the psychological aspects of that dog is. I might put my hands along their head, like I said to you, Mike, right? And then move or else around the rib cage. I might put one hand on top of their spine, maybe underneath their belly. It's all dependent on the dog's joy spot. And I talk about the dog's joy spot being the place where the dog themselves on an individual basis, individual preference, sentience, where the dog understands which way to be touched because that's where they like to be touched. Same thing like when you're going out with somebody, she may not have her, she may love having her, or he might like having, holding, some people like their hands held, some people like their arms around each other, some people don't want any public displays of affection. So it's all personal preference. The dog has personal places on their body that they like to be touched, and you'll see that. I want to say hi to some of the people who are actually trolling me, who have come online to watch me right now. Hi, everybody. Like I say, it's a welcome aspect of it. If you want to learn, you're more than happy to learn. So that's part is a passive training. And then we go on an active training. We can go on a moderate aspect of training. We can do an in-motion training, which reinforces that command of come, which is just a part of working on the dog psychology at the dog speed at 1/10 of a second. When we're working at the dog speed at 1/10 of a second, there's no such thing as unpredictable. So that means when you talk to a trainer or behaviorist and it says that the dog is unpredictable or we just don't know what's going on, means that that trainer or behaviorist is not seeing or evaluating your dog at 1/10 of a second. But they can. All of us can. Mike, you yourself did so tonight. Intuitively, you started picking up Ghost's her behavior and addressing it, and then what ended up happening, she started coming to you when she felt anxiety, and then she just kind of stood there, and she no longer was well-eyed, she was not like bug-eyed, she was like really soft eyes, right? And it was just so gorgeous to see the soul of your dog existing. So that's what we do, and when they do come, right, again, like I said, lovingly pet them, etc. So what that does do is, on that last line, it establishes a mutual codependency. It's not reciprocal. It's mutually shared. It's like you sitting on the couch with somebody, with your partner, and they reach over and they touch you with their hand, and then you start holding hands, watching this, watching TV together. The other part that I say to people is, remember when we were kids, and we were sitting in the kitchen, and I remember this, and everybody else I've talked to has had similar memories. You know, I'm sitting in the kitchen, I'm like 7 years old, I'm doing my homework, doing my homework, and my mom or dad, either one of them, knew that, you know, because I'm quite a wild organic kid at the time as well, and so they knew not to disturb me. And this is what parents, we do ourselves to our own children. We see them doing the homework, we see them studying in the kitchen, we know that we can't disturb them, otherwise they're going to be distracted, or it's going to be an excuse for them to be distracted. So what do? We walk over to them without saying a word, and we just put our hand on their shoulder in a very loving, soft, gorgeous way, and then we just move our hand off. That's what we do with this type of mutual codependent aspect of it, a nicer emotionality. when the dog is not in an arbitrary position of being commanded to do so, where they've created the initiative on their own end, they're in a different emotional state of mind as well. So then we address the dog in another multifaceted aspect of their psychology, of their codependency, of their bond with us. And it reinforces that bond even more so. So I'm going to go to the next one before I close off on this thing here, because I have to feed my dogs and it's like, they're going to get upset. I feed them like 200 to 300 pounds of raw a month. So they eat a lot. I don't eat meat myself, but I need to feed my dogs what is naturally indigenous to their diet to do so. So I'll just go over the things and I'll deal with it on another time, or I'll address it on another time. You know, when your dog comes running to you on his own, say the command, this is passive education that improves your dog's thinking, right? This is what I was saying before. When your dog does come when called but lingers, it's a great way to reinforce the command. There's context to that, though. There's context. It does, as I said earlier, it teaches your dog the connection of a less decisive action, right? That less need to be arbitrary. So the dog then starts to think more, and the dog is more reasoning. The dog is more cogent. The dog is more logical. The dog is more emotionally present and controllable of their own aspect. The dog learns how to self-regulate. The dog becomes a life. So when they do come on their own, you're reminding and reinforcing their normally arbitrary decision to come. When your dog comes but starts to linger, call out warm praise to them. This shifts your dog's attention back onto your command. Again, passive or in-motion training in that aspect of what I'm calling it. The next one is, when dogs circle, are they happy at dinner time? A dog that excitedly circles, is it deliberate? It signifies logical intelligence. It also signifies emotional intelligence as well. And the way the dog processes is by turning around in a circle, how they're turning around in a circle, whether or not they're happy or otherwise. And this is just the teaser, but I'll talk about it another time. And for some of you who have dysfunctional, highly dysfunctional, reactive dogs, when I explain it to you next time, you will understand, and the clarity will blow your freaking socks off, because you're like, I didn't realize that. I said that to you and Mike. I said that to you and Colleen tonight about what that means, and it makes sense now. Right? Then we talk about pain tolerance, and I know how dogs process pain. You know, we got the scientists out there talking about how dogs process pain, etc. I already talked about dogs processing time in abstract memory as if they're slideshows. That's why a dog will stand there beside you when you're eating, waiting for some food off the plate for an hour and a half, because to them, the timeline, they don't process time other than that aspect of abstract memory. And it's not a rhetorical aspect of it, nor is it a redundant aspect. It's a processive aspect of it. And that's why I say the scientists, the psychologists, Temple Grandin, all these people have no idea what they're talking about, because they don't deal with the predatorial type of behavior in dogs. So they have no reason to think anything better than the 60% of the dogs or animals that they're successful with and the other 40% that they kill. If you haven't worked 100% of the scale, you're never going to know what you're talking about, because you're at 60%. That's why when I read stuff like this, it's like reading a child's crayon drawing. You know, it's like hearing a kid tell me why the sky is blue. You know, and that's why these behaviors and scientists have no idea what they're talking about. And that's why I have novel interest from somebody who spoke at Harvard and presented on that, on behaviors aspect of it. So these are the things that make sense, and it just takes one person that has no ego at the top of the food chain to start saying, you know what, let's try something different. Let's do it for the dog's lives. Let's see what James is talking about, and why does it work with him when he's working with the most predatorial dogs that have deliberate intent to kill me. So then the next one was a reactive dog on the bed. Is it guarding or attacking? And all that aspect is a psychological basis of that. Is an insecurity? Is it an aspect of territory or protection? Is that a comfort level? Is it the cave? Is it all these blah, 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 blah? And when the explanation is given to you on the dysfunction of the dog, of the reactivity of the dog, then it'll make sense to you all. And you'll be like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. And then how do we address it? Then it'll be like, oh, that makes sense. And if you have any questions, because I'm going to be ending this soon, please comment below and I'd be happy to answer it. Otherwise, I'm just going to end up finishing after this going over bumps and cars. So, you know, hopefully all this stuff is making sense to everybody. If you have any questions, ask me. But I think a lot of times people say, "Oh, you know what? It makes sense." That's right. It does make sense. You see, I'm wearing a Vancouver Firefighters t-shirt. I want to say thank you to Craig Piddock for giving me this t-shirt. It's very, very cool, man. Really love that. I don't mind advertising the firefighters. They're an amazing, amazing species of human beings, an amazing genus of human beings. These are people who have no political affiliations. They have no public agenda other than to save lives. And guys like Craig and any other firefighter out there, any 911 responder, like the ambulance drivers, you know, even with the police, regardless of any of the, you know, political aspects that go on and the racial aspects that are so prevalent in everything going on. These are people who would give their life to save ours, right? I talk about dogs. They would get, our dogs would defend us with their lives. These are firefighters. These are police officers. These are ambulance drivers. And ambulance drivers, oh my gosh, you guys are phenomenal. But these are people who are willing to risk their lives going into a society that of people that they don't know if they're going to survive, that they might get knifed. What happened in, I think it was in Europe earlier today or yesterday, where four police officers were knifed to death by a psychotic terrorist. So, you know, personally, I don't have a problem working with a dog, and I've worked with the dogs. As again, you know, everything I say is truthful. There's no embellishment, everything like that. I have no problem working with dogs that are extremely dangerous. I mean, like I said to you, Mike, tonight, I've had a dog who's 2.5-3 feet away from me, and if I move, and they just watch and they stare. And they watch, and there's no growling, there's no breathing, they're controlled, and it's brutal. I deal with that, and I can deal with that, and I have no problem, because I'm out there to save the dog's life and to help them heal. Firefighters, police officers, ambulance drivers, ambulance personnel, I'm sorry, they're going into situations, you guys are going to situations where you know the risk of being killed is going to happen from the hands of a human being that deliberately wants to kill you or make you to harm you. So, you know, let's give much more reverence and respect to the firefighters out there, to the police officers, and to the ambulance personnel that are willing to give that part of them. You know, ambulance drivers, paramedics. I'm sorry, paramedics. I know you guys are like, the guy's getting it wrong. Paramedics. I mean, paramedics are going to the most difficult, horrific environments often. They are seeing people die every day, and they are often the last people to see your loved one, your mom, your dad, your brother, your sister, your best friend, your neighbor die. And that is, you know, just next time you see them, pay it forward, buy them some coffee, go to their local firefighter fire hall, go to your local, the police aspect, get them, you know, with the fire hall, you can drop off the stuff in person, you know, food and all that stuff. When you go to the police department, I mean, it's kind of a bit difficult because they can't really accept stuff like that, but, you know, you can always talk about arranging stuff like that or donating to their funds and so forth like that, because they're, again, just let's embrace humanity for the human beings that are out there to save our loved ones' lives and our strangers' lives without fear of their own. I mean, you know, can you imagine how they felt? Okay, so I'm going to go over the last thing here before I finish this off. So if you have any questions, any comments, please ask them now and I'll go through them. And tomorrow I have my group session with Second Chance in Life, and I'll be working with four dogs that are skittish, etc. And I want to thank Second Chance in Life for reaching out to me again and having a full month of group sessions that are all full. And I have a couple of my own that I put up on my own end, but thank you again, Second Chance. They are bringing in dogs in from Taiwan, and a lot of these dogs can sometimes be skittish or fearful because animal cruelty is quite prevalent in a low-educated society with troglodytes and Neanderthals that are out there. It's, you know, cruelty to animals comes from the low education. Cruelty to animals comes from the low emotional context of processing. It's an ignorant person's ability to be cruel. It's an intelligent person's ability to love. All right, so the thing I'm talking about is going over bumps in cars. I know I'm going to shift it off because I'm just timeline's just going tough here. And again, look at Lincoln. He's not yelling. All right, so going over bumps in cars. So what I'm saying is, everybody, we love to take our dogs for a ride in the car. And, you know, we go left, we go right, we stop, we speed up, we go over bumps and so forth like that. To let your dog know that you're taking care of them, announce what you're doing. So if you're going to go through a park and you see the speed bumps to slow people down, I always say, as I'm approaching, I say, George, here comes a speed bump. And I don't say anything else. Then as we hit the speed bump, there's a bump, 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 as we go over it. Okay, we're over the bump, and then that's it. And I say, good boy. So then I reinforce to that to my dog, going over the bump, my word, conversationally speaking, bump. I'm going over the bump. So they understand that next time they hear a bump, they brace themselves so they don't get bounced up. Because it's not funny for a dog to be bounced up in a vehicle because they can't predict it's going to happen. And it's frightening because all of a sudden now the ground is unstable. So that's empathy. But we train our dog, we teach our dog through conversation that we're going to hit a bump. Bump, going over it, etc. When you go left, and if it's a sharp turn, I'm turning left. Okay, we turned left. I'm turning right. I'm slowing down. I'm braking. Well, I say slowing down. I'm slowing down. Okay, light's green. We're going. And then you can teach your dog to anticipate turns so that they're not being thrown all over the place. At the same time, you're communicating with your dog. You're having a conversation. You're conversing with your dog, and you're letting them know what you're doing. So you're announcing to them, you're protecting their behavior, their safety, by letting them know that this is what's going to happen. And your dog learns those words, and then they start to prepare themselves, and then they relax, because they go, okay, good, now Dad said this and this. One of the other things that you can do with that command, and I use conversational words, so that the word go has a huge amount of applications and definitions to the dog as it does to us human beings. So when I use go... to make them go forward. I use the word go to make them leave the room. Go out, go, right? Leave, go out. I make them use that word go back. All those types, right? Because it's a verb, right? It is, I think it's a verb. Yeah, it's been a few decades. It's to go forward, etc. And here's the beautiful part that you can do too as well. And everyone goes, well, this is impossible and you can't and dogs don't know. But you can teach a dog to go their left. You can teach a dog to go right. You can teach a dog to go straight. You can teach a dog to heel. You can teach a dog to sit. You can teach a dog to come. So go left, go right, go straight. That's it. Makes sense. When you're walking and you're turning the corner, and I always say to people, never cut corners. In the beginning, when you're training your dog, especially on leash, never cut corners. And I'll get into that some other future time. But go left. So if I'm turning left, it'll be... Sam, go left. And then I turn and then I walk left and they go, oh, okay. And I go right. And then they go right and they go right. And then what ends up happening is over time, they learn to understand that so that when you're walking with them and you're approaching something and they normally would go right, you say, go left. And they're like, what? And you can see them pause like they're trying to think it through. This is not the right command. And then over time, as you do it more and more so, the dog learns to go left or to go right. I remember my beloved Lincoln, the great day, great day, right, reactive and et cetera and all that stuff, as I said before, took him to the vet. This is the time before he started declining, and I took him to the vet, and we're going through the vet from the back room, the whatever, I can't even think of the room, I don't have my language today. But, you know, going from the examination room and had to walk through the hallway and then out through the front of the desk, you know. And I would say, okay, Lincoln, go left, because the corner was left. And then I would say, okay, Lincoln, go right, because then there was another corner. Like it was a split, like a T intersection, and he would go right. And then the staff was just like, oh my gosh, he's so cute. Lincoln knows his left and right. Well, he's such a smart dog. Yeah, he is a smart dog because he understood what I was talking to him in a conversational manner. And he learned his left and he learned his right. Minky, stop it, please. He learned his left and his right through the command. And then he started to learn which way was left, which way was right. He learned that on his own through reinforcement of that same command over and over. And it's mundane and it's repetitive. And like, oh my gosh. Minky, you're okay. And so by teaching him to go left, he learned it. By teaching him to go right, he learned it. Teach him to go straight, and I'll do that. If I'm standing there, you know, like we'll stop the dog from running around or whatever, and just waiting, like at an intersection or a red light to cross, and then the light turns green, and the dog is waiting, go straight. Or let's go, but go straight. Always using the same key verbs, which instills in the dog action, which instills in the dog processing, reasoning, thinking through of what that word means. It means to move, doesn't mean to move forward, doesn't mean to move left, doesn't mean, means to move, it means to create an action. And then I add it on with the next wording, the next aspect of left, right, or straight, and then the dog starts to understand, okay, it's an action word, and then they understand a direction on that part. And then, you know, it's left, straight, or right, or to stop. Then the dog understands the conversation more. Because we're using the words go in real life when we're talking to our friends. Right? We're going to, you know, go somewhere. Let's go here. Let's go there. Whatever. I'm not good with making analogies with humans today. So we teach our dog left, straight, right by saying go left, go right, go straight. And we keep the same phrasing all the time. Inside the house, outside the home, and then we create that language that the dog then understands. And the dog starts to think things through, and the dog becomes more intelligent. One of the biggest things I was saying to Mike tonight and Colleen was that the dogs that are predatorial are actually smarter dogs. All right, so anybody has any questions, let me know. If you have any comments, please. And again, in closing, please share my post. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Please, subscribe to my Twitter account. Please help me get this word out. Everything that I've said, it's all making sense. It's logical. It's just simple. I have had people say it's brilliant and all stuff. It's just logical. It just makes sense. I'm the person who took the fortune cookie and kind of opened it up and said, this is what it really means. It's not anything that you can't do yourself. So, you know, I'm teaching everyone how to do this. You can do it yourself. And there will be people, as more and more people learn what I'm talking about and learn that there's a psychological aspect, there will be more and more people that will be as proficient as me. There should not be any reason that I should be the only one in this world that does what I can do and that can read dogs in this way. I that's my dream, is that there will be people out there who will be even better than me to save the lives of dogs, to look at psychology of dogs in the most visceral, rudimentary, quantum perspective of what's going on. That's why I say I can read dogs at 0.2 seconds. That's why people who have said to me, well, intermediate bridging and blah, 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 and then, you know, soon they were predicting their dog's movement before it was happening. It's intuition. It's our intuition. We are all primitive to begin with. We have that core at our brainstem. We have that core there. So it's up to you all to help spread the word, help save lives of dogs. You are going to learn so much more as you follow through the rest of the stuff that I'm talking about. I might do pain tolerance, which, like I say, it's just going to blow your mind. I have over 100 topics. That I was going to write a book, but, you know, this is easier for me because I'm not great at structure, obviously. But you know, there's just so many aspects regards to, like, you know, why, how can dogs look at something like a squirrel in a branch and notice that, or how, in a tree with leaves and everything, how does a dog know that, right? And it's an aspect of anticipation, redundancy, rhetorical. It's just a whole bunch of stuff, right? The science isn't picking up because they just don't see dogs in anything other than we anthropomorphize our conjecture on the dog, and that way we're the human apex predator, and the dog suffers from that. The dog becomes victimized. You know, actually, Mike, one of the great things was brought up was the aspect that there are people out there who say you only follow the people that have accreditation, you know, diplomas, and how often they go and re-educate themselves and refresh their education and all that stuff. I have zero training. I have zero education in this. It's all organic. It's all talented that I have, a gift that I have that is shared to me with me from God. And that part is, if I did the traditional stuff, I would be afraid of dogs, as I've said before. By not having any prior knowledge on how to train dogs or to understand dogs, it allowed me to figure it out on my own. And being faced with dogs that are dangerous, I had to learn how to survive without being killed. I mean, it hurts like crazy to be bitten, even nipped. It hurts like crazy because when you have a dog whose head is 2 to 3 times bigger than mine, and when they close down with their 700 plus PSI bite strength just to nip me, just to warn me, they don't just lacerate my skin. They leave bruising that surfaces 2 to 3 days later because it's so impacted, because their teeth are the size of my thumbnail. It's difficult to do that. And if I went through the traditional aspects of saying, well, I'm going to give this predatorial dog a treat, which the predatorial dog won't give a crap about it when they're facing you, wanting to see me move in a deliberate manner so that they can then have an excuse to attack me, giving them a treat would do absolutely nothing but further create distrust in them. And that's why you talk to the trainers, behaviors that say a dog at a certain point of time frame, bite level 6, right, that Ian Dunbar, the rhetorical, simplistic, inane scale, that's why those dogs don't respond to treats at his bite level 6 that cause death, because he's trying to feed dogs treats that don't exist in the canine species. No food in the canine species. But Dr. Ian Dunbar says, let's give them food. That's what works. Oh, the dog doesn't take the food. We need to kill the dog. They're not recognizing what's going on. They're not recognizing the psychology of what's going on. So when you're feeding a dog with that aspect of it, they don't understand. So then you have these people at the top of the food chain, right? You know, I got trolled by Learburg. L-E-E-R-B-U-E-R-G or B-U-R-G. Go check out one of my live broadcasts. He foolishly trolls me, and this guy is just like, he buys his subscribers too, which is just pathetic. But he trolled me saying, what is this foolish, idiotic stuff? He doesn't understand any of it. And then I asked him, well, in the response I said, how do dogs process pain? How do dogs process time? What does tail wagging mean? What does full pupil erection, what does half hackles in the front and back mean? No answer. And then he edited his comment a second time. These are the people who don't understand what's going on, and they're at the top. And the sad part is, when they're talking about accreditation and everything like that, these accreditation industries, facilities, they don't allow cross-training. They don't allow cross-education. So they're just stuck in their own little envelope every day. Sorry, I was just trying to do perspective here. They're stuck in their little tiny world, in their ivory tower. The emperor's new clothing. They're stuck there. And they can't get away, so there's no cross-education. If Bruce Lee was like that, no cross-education, don't learn martial arts from the Japanese or from the Bolivians, don't learn anything, don't learn boxing, there would be no Bruce Lee. He'd be just a mediocre nobody. There would be no Jeet Kune Do, you know, from Wing Chun and all that stuff. There would be nothing. There would be no martial arts change. And if it did happen, it would have been stunted by that. So when you have these accreditation industries, right, it's a multi-million dollar industry. When you have these accreditation things saying you can't cross-educate, then you're just blinders on for the rest of your life. And then when people say you got to go to somebody who has, you know, certification and so forth like that, you're signing, for those of you with a dangerous dog, you're signing your dog's death warrant. Because what ends up happening is they're going to take your money. Because if they deny you right off the bat, then you go, yeah, I told my dog, my trainer about my dangerous dog, and this, he's the best in the world, and he turned me down, which means he must be afraid of my dog. So he's not the best in the world. Or they do their cool trick is they take your money, of course, because they're gonna, you know, they want the money. You know, I think one of the behaviors, it's like $450 for an hour, and then they'll just prescribe a medication and throw some treats over the wall out of safety, and then buy the Gucci shoes with your money. So the thing is that I just not anti-establishment. I just don't think it's cool to make money off the despondency of owners who are desperate for help. It's just, there's no scruples there. It's unethical. It's immoral. So when you go into a trainer that says that, you know, you got to go to the accreditation and so forth, and they're at the top of the food chain, and then when they go and work with that, your dog, they're going to, because two things, again, they want to make sure that they don't get seen as the person that denied your dog because they couldn't handle your dog and they were afraid. And second is they have to prove that there's a problem with your dog, so they save their reputation. So they say to you, yeah, I'll work with your dog. They go to your dog and they'll spend one session, and they may not even see your dog, which is not just with you today, Mike, but with other people. They'll sit there at the, I've heard people sitting, behaviors, this doctor, she's sitting at the table in the kitchen watching their reactive dog on the other side of the pony wall, and never interacting with their dog other than throwing a couple treats over the pony wall, which the dog will take. And then when the dog gets amped up, the owner was saying then the dog or her dog wasn't taking treats anymore. And then what does the behaviors do? There's something wrong with your dog. Here's some medication, $200 later. And then the beautiful part about it is when you go to a behaviorist, they write out a report about your dog that is legal. So that means the next time your dog has a reaction after you've gone and seen this behaviorist that's written out the report for you, and then there's an incident that happens, and then you say, oh, you know, I took my dog to this behaviorist, or animal control might find out or know somehow because a neighbor will talk or something like that. And then animal control contacts the behaviorist and says, let's look at this report. And then, like, I'm laughing because I want to cry. I'm so frustrated. And then what happens is the animal control looks at that report and says, you know what? Even this behavior set, your dog is dangerous. And that there's no way to help your dog. And you were already instructed to do certain things to help your dog, but you didn't do it. So then now we have your behaviors as a legal report already establishing a background that just incriminated your dog towards a doom. Pretty cool, huh? Pretty cool. That's what people aren't thinking about. So that's how the danger can happen. But anyhow, back to that aspect of talking about trying to get a trainer or behaviorist that has accreditation. Hey, you know what? I will put my work pound for pound, danger for danger, with any trainer or behaviorist that says I can't do what I can do. Not to brag, not to show off, but to share what I'm doing. And like I said, I am looking for another extremely dangerous Great Dane, 150 pounds or heavier, 36 inches at the withers or taller, must have attacked between 6 to 9 people minimum. Look at my Vancouver Sun article. I'm not making any of this up. You tell me who else out there that's accredited is going to be able to say that and going to be able to have the consistency of that reputation of being able to say, I've worked with every single dog. And I've been able to downtrain every single dog and get them out in public, being able to be petted, associating with other dogs, off-leash parks, downtown, etc. Stop, please, Minky. So the accreditation is only helpful if you have the person that's talented behind it and if they're actually spending time. But if that master dog trainer is sitting there, or the PhD behaviorist is sitting at your kitchen table and doing nothing, you're buying them a pair of Gucci's. And what do you have after they leave? You have a dog that they just said is not going to be fixed. And then you have a legal report from your behaviorist that dooms your dog, that incriminates your dog. It's pretty insidious, isn't it? When you think about it. You see how this industry loves to suppress? And I'm not just like being upset and irate. I'm just disgusted and I'm saddened, and I keep it as even business-like tone as I can for that voice key for sure, but also to that point of just trying to express my frustration. I'm not angry. I'm not upset in that sense of it. It's just frustrating. It's irritating that we're killing dogs this way. We're dooming our dogs without realizing we're dooming our dogs. And we're going to people who live on their accreditation and so forth like that. Like even the BCSPCA, they have their animal kind certification program. And these guys, the BCSPCA, which I think made $39.1 million in donations in 2018. And they're always got their hat out there saying, please, please donate, donate. $39.1 million with a $2 million paid to the salaries. So they're saying, please give us money, please give us money, please give us money. And then have the Animal Kind Certification Program here in British Columbia saying that they're able to certify dogs. Dog trainers. And they charge this exorbitant amount because, you know, it's all about the money, not about the dogs. And then the SPCA, British Columbia SPCA, killed a puppy that they couldn't even train. And it's in the global news. If you Google it, I'll put the link in here. They killed a puppy that nipped the new adopter's pant leg at the shelter. And this is the BCSPCA asking for your donations to help support that type of abhorrent behavior. This is the BCSPCA saying, we want your money to certify a dog trainer or behaviors under their animal kind program. Lincoln, and everybody's getting a little antsy now. So I'll end it soon. But so that's what they're doing. Animal kind. It's an expensive certification program by an organization that couldn't even stop, please. Thank you. That couldn't even down train a puppy. They killed the dog instead. They killed a puppy. Lincoln, stop. Stop, please. They killed a puppy. Again, see voice control, right? Voice command. We're doing. Lincoln, stop. Thank you. Lincoln. Lincoln, stop. 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 Hi, Lincoln. Lincoln. Hi, silly boy. Hi, Lincoln. Great. And he just yawned just now. All right. So the other part about that BCSPCA thing, I just love this fact because I was going to end it like 20 minutes ago. Not only do they have their animal kind dog trainer certification program / joke because they can't even train a puppy that they killed, the North Vancouver SPCA, so they killed that, is think about what they've just done is the poetic license, how I'll say that, because I won't say it's not plagiarism, but it's poetic license. They call it animal kind. Ellen DeGeneres has something called Be Kind. Miki, stop. Thank you. Ellen DeGeneres' program, or her thing that she calls, is Be Kind. B-E, kind. Be kind. And then you have Animal Kind. Coincidental, isn't it? Not plagiarism. Whoever's in their marketing department must be laughing their pants off. And the board of directors, they're just smiling to the food bank because they get to take care of everything and make themselves look great around the rest of the little people who need their help. We need to change the world for dogs. We need to get rid of that type of self-interest. We need to get rid of that type of arrogance and our departure from reality. This is why I say the accreditation aspects, the industries have no idea what they're talking about. They have a 60%, if not lower, success rate with dysfunctional dogs. I have 100% success rate across the board. Skittish, fearful, insecure, etc., etc., across the board. At the end of the day, who are you going to listen to? You're going to listen to the person who can bat you 1,000 every single time at the plate? Or are you going to have the person that's batting you 0.06%? Not even a real percentage point. Nothing. Insignificant. Because there's 6 million dogs being killed annually. All right. I'm going to let you all go. I will probably talk about some of the other things next time. I might go over some other stuff instead. Just depends what's going on. Depends what happens for my group session tomorrow with the Skittish dogs, etc. We'll go from there. Lincoln, stop. Thank you. Again, everything works. Again, once again, there you go. Proof in the pudding. My work works. Minky. So Minky has a bone. Anthony is around there. Anthony is extremely food-driven. William is extremely food-driven as well. So is Minky. And they're right there. And they were just doing that part of just dealing with it. That's how close. You can hear how close they are. Minky. Minky. All right, we're just watching timing. All right, guys. Take care. And, is the pit bull really different than any other dog? It's psychology. They have nuanced behaviors that are indigenous, that are indigenous to their own type of behavior. Like, you know, I don't mean to be idiotic when I say things like, you know, like Chinese people are supposed to be good at math, right? I can say when I was in grade 5, my dad was getting me to do algebra in grade 5, and then grade 6 and 7, I was doing physics and stuff like that. But when it comes to the pit bull and all that stuff, the psychology is always the same. If you look at the fact that there's like supposed to be like 6 or 8 key human personality traits or personality envelopes, same with a dog, but they're all going to have some key. Minky, can you stop, please? Yeah, they're getting hungry. I'm sorry. Stop, Minky. 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 So Minky just actually got up, walked away from the bone, and Anthony grabbed it instead. That's resource guarding. That's Minky understanding and trusting me. Hi, silly boy, you're okay. William, stop. And I always have a fear because Minky's can be kind of nippy sometimes. So Minky got up, left the bone. He didn't get into a fight. Resource guarding. All the dogs are specifically resource guarded. William, stop. And then Anthony went and picked up the bone right in front of Minky. No fight. So the pit bull is not any different. And actual fact is a lot of the misinterpretation of the behavior of the pit bull. They're happy dogs. Anybody who has a pit bull is going to tell you, my pit bull has that bully wag, right? The tail wagging is so incredibly violent and emotional that their whole body moves. They're so happy and they have that huge smile and everything. So it's in the emotional context of the dog so that they are so highly codependent on the human being that their ability and their desire to defend us to the death is so strong. So that's why they're focused on it. So they're more of an emotionally based dog than a logically based dog. And I'll talk about logic and emotions and the sentience and the human consciousness some other time. But the pit bull is very much similar. And I've worked with pit bull. I have some pit bull video with the pit bull as well on my YouTube channel. I look under the Hey Dog, You're Okay playlist. And you see a pit bull that was deemed dangerous by North Vancouver. And had to be muzzled and all that stuff. 2 years, wasn't around other people, was reactive. You see in the video, it's quite strong reaction to me and other people, and can't be around other dogs, etc., etc. And literally in 2 hours, he was around people and other dogs coming up to him for the first time in his 2 years. And on top of that, I actually noticed without any prior knowledge is that this pit bull, Brando, had a hind end issue and was creating a somewhat adjusted gait that wasn't noticeable to anybody, to the previous trainer that they had, or future trainer, whatever. And then I said, you know, there's something wrong on this side of the leg. You can see the part he suffered an injury somehow. And the foster said, yeah, he got hit by a car when he was young. We can notice these things, right? When we see somebody walking down the street, we can notice that they're walking, okay, you know, and I don't mean to be sexist, but you know, when you see a woman walking down the street in high heels that are too high for her, you can see that she's not comfortable in the heels, right? You already know that. As a woman, you already know that. You could already, oh, yeah, she's not used to heels. And then you see somebody who knows how to walk in heels, and they're like, oh, my gosh, just, like, amazing. I wish I could walk like her, right? Not me, but you, right? You say that and you're like, oh, wow, that's amazing. So you're noticing those nuances. The same thing when we see our dog walking. We're noticing the nuances in the way the dog has a gait, their walking gait, their cadence, their rhythm, the way that there's a pattern and rhythm, the way each of the four paws, legs walk. And then we understand that what that happens. When it comes to the pit bull, again, they're highly emotional in the codependency aspect of it. They're above emotions. I don't know why people are angry about this. Whoever did an angry face about that, about pit bulls being highly emotional. It's other than, let's figure out who this person is. Does anybody know who it was that's hating pit bulls now? So the pit bull is similar in psychology to all the other dogs because, again, like I said, everything that I do works across the board. It's just the fact that it's the understanding of their psychology and that codependent level is much more higher in the pit bull. So then we want to address it. We address it in a way by addressing their codependency, which can borderline into the interdependency. So then we go, okay, you know what? We want to bring the dog down to a more cognizant, more present perspective of what's going on of their environment so that they're not getting too emotionally up in that level, and then we get them down, and then like, okay, and we keep that stability. Kind of like when a dog is reactive, we work them down so that they're stable and that they can trust us. And same thing with the pit bull. And you'll see the Brando video, like I said, is I do the impossible, but it's not impossible because his fosters are doing it. So it's not a surprise, right? So everyone can learn this. And so that's it. I am going to end it off because I think I'm running over like an hour and a bit again. Like I said, I could do this for literally 5 years, 10 years, and just continue addressing all these things, but it makes sense what I'm talking about. So once again, please share my posts. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel. The link is in the comment, in my description. Please follow me on Twitter and all that stuff. Please help me get out this really simple way of training dogs that will save their lives and save your friends' dogs' lives. And it'll change the way we see dogs and understand that they are sentient. They are functional sentient beings with an incredible brilliance of life, and we need to respect that. All right, and so now Minky is licking Anthony right here in front of me. Hi, Anthony. Hi, silly boy. You see the tone of voice that I use with Anthony, with Minky, in my videos, everything. It's always, hi, silly boy. It's always the same. There's a key tone that I created, a certain affectation. There's a little bit of inflection adjustment for each dog because of the way they listen to me, to you. And then we make the adjustment and we go from there. I hope everybody enjoyed it. Please leave some comments in the bottom when you're done. I will read them all. And then I make the adjustment of what I can talk about next time. I hope everybody is enjoying what I'm doing. And, thank you so much for listening to this guy who's got some new way of looking at things. All right, take care. Till we meet again.